All right. So for our topic for today's AI-driven approaches for drug discovery, novel antiviral peptide generation, ligand pools identification, and more. I know there are a lot of jargons for tech folks. We'll go through them as we move forward. Let's see what we have on the agenda. So we will briefly talk about the overall drug discovery process, what is happening in when we are rethinking about drug discovery in the era of AI. And in detail, we will talk about our current work, which is the generation of antiviral peptides, identification of the ligand pools, classification of compounds for drug-induced liver injury, and few other work. So to start with, say that now we'll go over a very brief overview of what the drug discovery process is to enable you with some of the terms that we are going to utilize throughout the session and help you understand them, and rest you can definitely ask any questions. So drug discovery process, to start with, what is a drug, right? So that's probably the first question. Can go to next slide. Yeah. So drug, a chemical substance, typically of known structure, which when administered produces a biological effect to cure, treat, or prevent a disease. We will try and understand the whole concept with a simple lock and key analogy. However, things are way more complex. We all must have seen through that over one and a half last year with COVID. But we will start with a very simple analogy where we are saying that a drug is the key here, and the lock here is the target or the actual gene or protein whose function has to be altered so that a biological action can take place, which results in curing a disease. For an example, if we take example of COVID, when COVID came in, nobody knew what it is, right? The first step was to identify where to target a human protein, COVID protein, where to target. So once the target was identified, the next step was to identify what are the right keys. And now we have a vaccine out for that. So I would leave you with two more terms. One is the binding site. Which is, so if you take a simple lock and key analogy, every lock has a keyhole where the key goes and fits in. So having that right position, right place where the key is supposed to go in, and the right orientation, which we call as a ligand pose, which is where it will actually produce a real biological action. So with this analogy, we'll go forward and look at the detailed process of drug discovery. Now, the drug discovery process, if I have to look the entire value chain, the research and discovery is one part of it. The other parts are like clinical development, manufacturing, launch, commercialization, post-market surveillance. So I'm going to skip all of the rest of the pieces as we are focusing majorly on the discovery piece. So to start with, just thinking back on the lock and key analogy, first thing for me is to identify the target. Be it COVID, be it diseases which do not have cures till now, like Alzheimer's, which is caused due to misfolding of a protein. A protein does not end up in a shape where it is supposed to. And that is where it causes the disease. So that first step is to identify what is the right target, validate that this is the place where for which we need to create the right keys. That is the part where we say target validation, which is mostly a gene, a protein, pathways, different metabolic pathways within the body. The second piece is the lead discovery. Now, what is a lead? A lead is the drug compound that we spoke about in the last slide. It starts with the lead. So a hit molecule, lead molecule, ligand, these are all interchangeable terms. So once you've identified the target, there are millions of libraries. There are libraries with millions of compounds, sorry. And those compounds are first screened. Like, okay, can this compound act against this particular protein? So with that, after that first screening, so it could be the compounds that are already available. It could be new synthetic compounds. It could be new compounds with using various generative methods. We'll talk about one of them in our slides ahead. And then from there, once you identify a few hits, to selection of a ligand. So that is where our other work will fall in, where you identify. So once you've identified the ligand, it's very important that you identify what is the right pose, what is the right way that the ligand will interact with the protein molecule so that they can have the desired biological action. So lead discovery basically is a part where you screen compounds and finalize a few. Once you've finalized a few compounds, the next step is the optimization. So that compound might need certain alterations, certain structural alterations to perform its action. And after that is the preclinical test. So what does preclinical test? So once you have identified that this is the right compound or this is a set of compounds which should be the ideal candidates. Now, it is important to understand that what will that compound do when it gets inside the body and what will the body do to the compound? So if the compound is supposed to take action on a protein, while it just dissolves as soon as you take it, that compound is not something that you are looking for. So those, so that includes a lot of other areas, like is it adsorption, is it distribution, is it metabolism, excretion, and lastly, and one of the most important and challenging area is the toxicity. So is the compound toxic? Some of the example, not very highly toxic, but yeah, a lot of drugs in market are rejected because they are toxic or because they act well where they are required to, but they do deposit in, say, liver that causes the drug-induced liver injury. And then eventually, it's very common to eventually some drugs are banned because they are causing more harm than actually what they have to do. So along with these side effects, these are the other aspects. So after preclinical test is the, you can just go back to the previous, yeah, the clinical trials. So this process is animal testing on human. And I guess everybody must have read a lot of updates while COVID was on that phase one, phase two, phase three trials are going on. And those are actual trials with smaller number of people, larger number of people. And then the steps which are mentioned here on the left side, the development and other steps carry on. So that's the entire process, which is quite overwhelming, quite exhaustive. And we go to next slide. And as you know, illustrated rightly here, that this is wonderful. It will help millions of people. Yes, in about 12 years. So that's the biggest challenge that drug discovery faces. Where the process is complex, it is lengthy, and it is quite expensive. So all of the phases that we spoke about, be it drug discovery, preclinical, clinical trials, and getting to the FDA review, start from maybe 1 million compounds, 10,000 compounds, and that reaches to one FDA approved drug. There are multiple challenges where these things are, where it doesn't work very well, but few of them is, one is the process is very lengthy. It is very, very complex to identify the biomarkers for the disease, identifying the right biomarkers and acting to them. Another thing is the translational failure using animal models. So if you see the clinical trials period, which is like 7 years, it is a lot of time the drugs work in animals, but when it is given to humans, it fails. So those are some very common challenges of the entire process. And that is where we believe that AI stepping in the process has been very helpful. Now, before we actually get into AI and you know how AI has been helping drug discovery, I just want to quickly briefly tell from where it has traversed, right? The 1700s time where it was observatory drug discovery. Take examples of aspirin, penicillin, which are very well known. Aspirin is more of an observational discovery, while penicillin is a eureka moment. So it mostly started with observations, making modifications, making changes to a eureka moment. Then it was streamlined where the rational drug discovery came into place. And in early 2000, there were independent softwares which will work on specific piece of the drug discovery process, which is still there and work quite efficiently. And beyond that, I guess post 2000, we started seeing that other than those independent, what is making an impact is the data-driven science or the AI ML methods, robotics, which is actually taking up the data-driven methods. Now talking about how AI has impacted the industry. If you look at, So if you look at the implementation of AI, what charms there is the data-driven approach of the modeling process, where it gives some kind of ownership, some kind of decision ownership to the machine intelligence along with the human intelligence. An example of that is a medicinal chemist who is working in a wet lab, an actual laboratory. they would be working on making some modifications to a particular compound, of adding fragments, joining fragments. And at the same time, if you look at from an AI perspective, AI would be making those decisions based on data distribution, statistical probabilities. So if you see both of these methods, what are they taking through is more than our chemistry textbooks, which tells you that this compound works and how these bonds are formed. It is learning from the training data. That is where I find this image very helpful, where it says that the future is with the mix of mind and machine. So creative collaboration, which has the potential to overall reduce the cycle, to overall enhance the cycle from design, make, test, analyze. And so along with this, we'll take some of the examples where AI has already established itself. You can go to the next slide. Where AI is already partnering in drug design. So these are some of the methods which are already established. So is it target prediction, identification of compound libraries, prediction of ADME, prediction of toxicity and these kind of properties, identifying new relationships which are not known so far, identifying the toxicity, identifying the selection of patients in the clinical trial population for efficient clinical trials. However, along with this, we believe that there are a couple of areas where we need to keep investing in AI so that we are able to get a great partnership getting the drug discovery accelerated by the use of AI. Few of them could be getting the right data set. Getting the right data set is equally critical in terms of machine learning, sure. But at the same time, if I take an example of toxicity again, now toxicity the in vivo or what is happening inside the experimental data is very limited, and synthetic data is quite high. So can I really form a relationship between the experimental data and synthetic data? So I need the right data to build my AI models. So that is one place where obtaining the right data set is important. Secondly, there has been a hypothesis being built based on medicinal chemistry, what AI brings in, right? Can we create new hypotheses? Can it help us in creating new hypotheses which have not been seen so far? Another aspect is the optimization problem. Drug discovery process from start to end has multiple spaces where the optimizations can be done. One of the problems we'll speak about in detail in the work that we have done, but that is another space where there is a lot of scope. Another space which is probably very prominent in biology is shareability of data. The open source data is quite limited available in biology. So these are a few of the areas where AI definitely can help in, and as we go further and keep providing that information, it is definitely going to be more and more helpful in the entire drug discovery process. So that was more about what the entire process looks like, how AI is painting that picture. And now we will step into what work we are actually doing. So for us, the three main problem statements that we worked on were generating antiviral peptides using generative models, reinforcement learning-based protein-ligand interaction, and classification of compounds for drug-induced liver injury. All of these problem statements, we participated in a drug discovery hackathon from the Government of India. And we have also advanced to phase two, which will start in next month. So I'll just quickly relate how these are related to the drug discovery process. So generating our antiviral peptides and reinforcement learning are the part of identifying the lead. So first step, identifying the leads. Are there antiviral peptides specifically? So they are a class of antimicrobial peptides, which are naturally found in the body, are our first line of defense. And they are studied a lot to see if they can at some point be a solution to the multi-drug resistant of antibiotics. An antiviral peptide forms a class in that, so which has a very limited experimental data. So generating new keys is what we're talking about here. In reinforcement learning based post prediction is optimizing. So once I have enough keys, now optimizing the right pose, identifying that this is the right pose, this will give me the right biological action. So I got the key, I need to see the orientation of the key is the second problem. And the third one we are going to talk about. So I have identified the key, maybe optimized it, got the right structure. Now doing a quick classification and looking at, is it toxic? is it a candidate of drug-induced liver injury? That's the third problem statement. I will now hand over to Shraddha to talk in detail about, to start with, Pandora GAN.
Thanks, Pooja. So now we've had an overview of the whole drug discovery lifecycle process. Going forward, we will be discussing three of the projects which we did as part of drug discovery hackathon, as Pooja mentioned. The first one is Pandora GAN. That's the name of our model, which generates antiviral peptides using GAN, which is a type of generative model. It is a generative adversarial network. So in this problem statement, we are trying to generate keys, right? So we are developing a generative adversarial network, which is GAN. A lot of people would have heard of GANs, especially in the context of deep fakes and creating fake images and creating text, etc. So we are trying to use the same methodology to generate sequences, to generate peptides, and in this case, focused on antivirals. So there are multiple factors that are involved in deciding what to make. So even in the real life scenario, like the non-AI world, there has to be some start process when a peptide needs to be synthesized, right? There are multiple factors that are involved. So design of biologically active molecules is not an exact science as such. A lot of experience also comes in there. So when deciding which drug to go ahead with, things like structure activity relationships, which are derived from laboratory experiments and modeling data are considered. And there are a bunch of other things that aid in the design of the process, which can include information obtained via NMR or X-ray structures of target macromolecules with or without complex ligands. So it is important to design drug-like molecules for target affinity and selectivity. They must also be optimized for other factors such as pharmacokinetic, metabolic, physical, and toxicological properties. So why am I highlighting all of this? So there are a bunch of factors that goes into designing a drug, right? And there are certain properties that are required for a certain drug to possess, which makes it what it is. So for an antiviral, it would require certain type of properties that make it antiviral. So given these enormous number of factors that actually go into designing a drug and it being a complex process, this forms a good case to apply a machine learning algorithm that would be able to understand the underlying patterns which are common across drugs. So what really makes an antiviral peptide antiviral? There must be some common structures, patterns underlying it. And the intention is for the machine learning model to be able to learn those. So we not only want to understand these underlying patterns, but we want to implement a model that will generate new antiviral peptides from the common pattern that it sees from the data of antiviral peptides that we give it, from the data of existing antiviral peptides that we give it. So here is where we use generative models. But before we go into generative models, let's understand antiviral sequences. And what does it actually look like? So if I'm giving an antiviral to a model, what does that look like from a model perspective? So over here on the screen are five examples of antiviral sequences. The building block of peptides. So sequence and peptides are used quite interchangeably. I might use them interchangeably as well over here. The building blocks of peptides are amino acids, which are these alphabets that you see on the screen. So each particular alphabet is one amino acid, which makes up this peptide, which makes up this sequence. Now, the sequence in which these amino acids are placed determines the structure of a protein, and the structure largely determines the functionality of a peptide or protein. So as such, there must be patterns in the sequences, in the way the amino acids are arranged, that leads to the presence of certain structures like rings and certain properties in the peptide as well, such as hydrophobicity, the charge, its entropy, Shannon entropy. These are all properties of a peptide. And having these values in certain ranges makes it antiviral. And these are important for its biological function. So the presence of certain patterns makes it useful, as in our case, it could be antiviral. Now, as there are these patterns in the peptides, machine learning models have been widely used in classifying whether a particular peptide is, say, antimicrobial or not and all. And they have been successful in that. So definitely machine learning models can understand some of the underlying properties of these peptides to be able to classify them. And our aim is to generate such peptides. So I'll quickly walk through a very simple generative adversarial network model, which we have used over here. GANs have been quite popular. So at least concept-wise, a lot of people know about them, but what does it actually involve? So I'll start with first a classification model, which is basically a discriminator model. So the generator and the discriminator are the two major components of a GAN. Model. So for example, if a machine learning model is to be created to classify between a cat and a dog, so it is, you give it images, a lot of images of cats and dogs, and it will classify whether it's a cat or a dog. So whether it belongs to class zero or class one, we attribute one to either. So in our case, what we want to do is create this classifier to be able to classify whether it is an antiviral peptide or not. Okay. So that's the discriminator module. The function of the generator module is to generate these antiviral peptides. So to start with, it will generate random sequences. So these sequences that we see over here, these are antiviral peptides. But to start with, the generator has no idea what antiviral peptides look like. So we create a framework for it where, for example, given that there are 20 amino acids which are represented by 20 alphabets, the generator module will create combinations of these 20 letters to create a peptide or a sequence. So that is what the generator creates and is given to the discriminator. Now the discriminator's job is to be able to distinguish between what has been created by the generator, so that is considered as fake samples, and what is coming from the actual real data, the actual antiviral peptides that we give it. So we give it a list of some antiviral peptides saying these are what antiviral peptides look like. It considers that as the real data samples. And the discriminator's job is basically to classify whether the peptide given to it has come from the real data sample or it has come from the generator. Now, the output of the discriminator is then given back to the discriminator so that it improves upon itself. But it is also given to the generator. So the generator understands how to fool the discriminator. So that's the whole game. The generator is trying to generate better and better peptides so it can fool the discriminator into classifying it as a real data sample rather than the fake one. And so this is how the generator is improved. It then understands the underlying distribution of the actual data that we get. What are the kind of peptides that make it an antiviral peptide? What are the distribution of the amino acids in a sequence? Is particular amino acid occurring very often in a particular sequence, or is there a combination that repeats specially in antivirals? So it will try to mimic that. And that's where we get the generator module, which we can then use to generate antiviral peptides. So this was the basic GAN. We have used a modified version of GAN called Leak GAN for our particular project. Now in all of this data, especially in the case of where fake images are generated, fake videos are generated, fake text are generated, they have a lot of data to train on, right? So these, the generator and discriminator, are both deep learning modules, which get access to a lot of data. And it has so much of data to learn on. So it has that much of information to understand. The major challenge in our project was the data. Unlike images and textual data, the amount of data for peptides available is very minimal. And that too, if we are going in something very specific, such as antiviral peptides, the number of data available, the number of antiviral peptides that are available, which we can take and train on, is very, very minimal. So we got peptides of the order of 500, out of which we curated and used only 130 peptides for our training. That was the biggest challenge, and it's the USP of our model as well, that we were able to train with such a less amount of data. So the accessibility and the quantity of the data available were the major challenges in this. Quickly going through the overall journey of this project, how we went about it. First and foremost was the data gathering phase. We knew that we want to generate antiviral peptides. So in order to do so, we need all possible examples and samples and peptides of antivirals that are available. We accessed various databases in order to do that. So there is an ABP PRED data from where we got about 550 sequences of antiviral peptides. The AVP DB sequence, we use certain filters such as less than 30 micromolar to get the antiviral peptide sequence. So we got about 450 sequences from there. Other databases were also CAMP, DRAMP, APD3 DB, AMP DBs from where we got sequences. Now, once we had sequences, we combined all the various data sources and filtered sequences with similarity higher than 90%. Now, since these sequences obtained were from different databases, it is likely that similar antiviral sequences would have occurred in these different databases as well. So we do not want to bias our GAN algorithm on these sequences, which on these similar sequences, which have many instances. So we remove similarity of sequences which are similar to each other by greater than 90%. And then totally we had a combined data set of 423 sequences. So these formed our antiviral sequences, a positive data set. But parallelly, we also manually curated peptides. So these were from literature and from the AVP database. And we got 130 sequences that had MIC value lower than 15 micromolar, which formed our highly active antiviral peptides. So you can think of the way I think of highly active antiviral peptides is just antiviral peptides which are of much higher quality, really good at their being antivirals. So they form really good instances to give to our GAN algorithm. Now we gave these to, we trained different types of GANs with sequences. We trained leak GAN, seek GAN, MALIGAN. These are all used in text generation, and we use the same logic where each amino acid sort of forms a word, and hence we could take these GANs, modify them, and use that for our purpose. Leak GAN was what gave really good examples of generated really well antiviral peptides. What it basically did was some part of the discriminator, what the discriminator has learned, it would leak it back to the generator. So the generator would get very fast feedback on the kind of antiviral peptides it is generating. So now once we have generated antiviral peptides, the next step is to calculate their physicochemical properties based on certain validation strategies which we have created. We will more on those. And certain post-processing of the generated sequences. So the antiviral sequences that were generated were of varied lengths. And one of the post-processing was to only accept sequences less than a particular length. We created some visual and statistical evaluation plots. And we also compared PandoraGAN peptides. So our model is called PandoraGAN. We also compared the peptides generated by PandoraGAN with the experimental data and the negative data. So experimental data is all the data that we gathered from the databases. And the negative data in this case are all the peptides which are non-antiviral, which we got from, which are basically antimicrobial peptide sequences which with unknown antiviral activities and some random non-secretory peptide sequences as well. Now, unlike a lot of projects where machine learning models are used, where we have a training set and then we have a test set which has the answers, right? So for any classification problem statement as well, if this was a classification problem statement, we would have peptides and we would also know whether they are antiviral or not. And we would hold out a part of this database to later on test the model on how well it is performing. So in that, we would already know that out of the holdout test data that we have, how many of those peptides it is actually classifying correctly. In this case, however, since we are generating antiviral peptides, to actually test them whether they are true antivirals and what properties they possess would require a wet lab to actually synthesize those peptides. So in order to validate, what we do is we created, we compared properties such as Shannon entropy, et cetera, of our peptides, of the generated peptides with the actual experimental peptides. But we'll see later that we also did some PC analysis to understand where they fall in the, where each of these peptides falls in the whole space. So a lot of the validation was visual validation and based on domain expertise. So quickly iterating the whole process, we trained a model with 130 highly active antiviral peptides. We used LeakGAN for a generative adversarial network, where high-level feature information from the discriminator is being leaked to the generator for better learning. Once the peptides have been generated, for validation, we used both statistical validation and evaluation of plots. In statistical validation, we saw correlations, and we did Mann-Whitney U-test with the already exist all the actual experimental antiviral peptides. And we did evaluation plots where we evaluated, where we compared various properties of experimental data, generated data, and the random peptide data. This work has been published on BioArchive, and all details can be found in this paper. The technology stack that we used is Python. We used TensorFlow to create our GAN, and we used PyPython and pfeature to generate properties of the peptides that we want to look at. So this is one of the evaluation techniques that we sought to understand how well our model is generating antiviral peptides. So if you see over here in this graph, this is a principal component analysis graph, which is basically we've calculated features. We've calculated features based on by PyPython and pfeature of each of the sequences. And then we have done a principal component analysis on it, which basically what it does is transforms that whole feature space into another dimension, wherein the first, wherein the importance of each feature keeps decreasing. So the first two components, which is the first two dimensions, will have the maximum information of the distribution of peptides in the latent space. So we have plotted over here the first two components of the principal component analysis. And we have plotted the peptides that we have. So each dot that you see over here is a peptide. The blue dots are highly active antiviral peptides. So these are peptides that we have gathered from various data sources. The green dots are the peptides that have been generated by our Pandora GAN. And the red dots are the non-antiviral peptides. So we see that there is a good overlap between the actual antiviral peptides and those generated by our Pandora GAN in this space. And there is a clear demarcation from the random peptides. There is some overlap over here, but that is to be expected. We are seeing only the first two dimensions. So this gave us good confidence that the kind of peptides Pandora GAN is generating is quite close to the highly active antiviral peptides that we have collected from all the databases. We have posted this on Heroku, and I'll quickly just show you how it would work. So this is the antiviral peptide generation server, and we can generate some antiviral peptides. Okay. I thought it might take time, so I have opened tabs for the same. We can mention the number of sequences, antiviral sequences that we want to create, say if we mention 10 and generate, so it will generate sequences. Which will look something like this. So if you've given 10, it will generate some 10 sequences. We can go in detail for its properties, and it will also highlight other properties such as what is the molecular weight, aromaticity, instability index, etc. of the generated peptides. So immediately domain expert can understand which of these would make good use cases to explore further. We can go deeper and see the property of particular peptides. So we can see the amino acid composition of each of the peptides. What is the percentage compared to the overall? So going back to the presentation. Right. So that was for Pandora GAN. Do put in your questions so we can address them shortly. For now, Justin will go ahead and talk about the reinforcement learning-based protein ligand interaction project.
Thank you, Shraddha. So in the previous section, what we have seen is how to generate keys in the terminology of the key and log terminology. So in the current process, what we are trying to do is we are trying to figure out how to fit this key, what exactly is the right orientation the key should fit into the log. Okay. So once we have generated these drug molecules, we would want to do three steps. First is identify the right drug which would act on the protein. The second step would be to identify the right orientation of the drug, which should fit into that active site of the protein. And finally, where is that active site of the protein itself? Okay, so in terms of the analogy aspect, I have keys. Now, first, I would have to identify the right key for the lock. The second aspect would be I would want to actually fit it into the keyhole. Otherwise, I mean, I just can't keep the key on top of the lock and expect the lock to open. So I have to practically keep it inside, push it inside the lock, keyhole. And the third one is the pins of the tumbler pins of the lock should interact with the key in such a way that it can open the key, open the lock. So that is what this particular problem statement is all about. We are trying to identify the right pose of the ligand such that the activity or the reaction it has with the protein is the maximum. Okay. So in this problem statement, we are trying to kind of identify the active site and the pose which would work for that active site. Now, a way to understand this problem is a simpler way to understand this is the Tetris game. So we all have played the Tetris game where we have blocks coming, falling from the sky. And what we are supposed to do is we have to find the right orientation of that block so that it fits exactly in a good pocket and we can earn the maximum score out of it. Similarly, in the drug discovery process, we have the ligand, which are the blocks falling from the sky. And the protein has these pockets where these drugs can fit into. So we have to figure out which particular orientation of the drug kind of fits in properly. If we do not do that, the drug would not react with the protein and it would be just a wasted effort. So we want to find the actual orientation of the drug. And we were supposed to do this problem statement using reinforcement learning. Okay, coming to reinforcement learning. So reinforcement learning, unlike classification and regression or prediction, in reinforcement learning, we specifically do not have data which towards to use to train. Okay, so what we have is an environment on which we know what the favorable scenario is all about, and we want the agent to practically learn the favorable scenarios. And for that, we have a reward mechanism. So what the agent does is it looks at the environment, it generates a representation which it can understand, which is known as the state. And using this state, the agent tries to take an action. And when this action is applied onto the environment changes state. Now, if this state is a favorable state, a favorable reward is generated for the agent so that that particular state and action combination can be reinforced, or it would be penalized so that the agent knows that for this particular state, I should not be doing this action. So overall, that is how a reinforcement learning approach works. Now, taking the example of Tetris. So initially, what the agent is going to do is the agent is randomly going to place the blocks everywhere. And the agent places a block in the right slot. And there is a score. The agent receives a reward. Now, agent knows that given this particular state of the game, I have to practically rotate the block in such a way that it can fit in. And that would help in generating the reward. Now coming to the overall journey of the problem statement. So in a problem statement, what we want to achieve is a good docking position for the ligand. So what we started out with is already experimented protein and ligand combinations. So for which we know that this particular ligand fits in particular pose. Now that becomes our input data where we prepare the protein and the ligand. Now, and that is the final state where the agent needs to reach after training. Now for training, what we do is we take out this ligand out of that protein molecule in space and provide the agent with a ligand, which the agent needs to fit it into the protein, so that it can finally reach the experimental position of that particular protein ligand molecule. For that, we need the representation. So we just cannot take the raw protein and ligand data. We need to convert it into a representation which the agent can understand. And post that, we need to embed certain features. So in this case, we had to embed atomic protein and ligands atomic features and spatial features, because these two compounds kind of interact in the spatial domain. So there is a spatial 3D structure in which they interact. And post-training, reinforcement learning training and testing, we come up with a model which is kind of a an optimized function, which when provided a protein and a ligand, it is going to predict a pose which will lead to the highest reactivity between those two molecules. Next slide. Okay, for the approach, first is the molecule representation. So in this case, we went with graph CNN. We could have used 3D convolution networks, but 3D convolution networks are computationally expensive. So we went with graph CNN. The only downside of using graph CNN is we lose the 3D spatial representation of the molecule. Now we have a 2D structure of the molecule, where the connections are the atomic connections between the atoms in that molecular structure. And to overcome the spatial issue, what we have done is we have embedded the spatial features into the nodes itself, so that the agent can utilize those spatial features for training. For reinforcement learning, our problem statement lies in the continuous space domain. So our input space is the feature vector of the protein molecule and the ligand molecule, which is continuous in nature. And the output is a translation and rotational values, which again are in the continuous state space. So we have used DDPG, that stands for Deep Discriminatory Policy Gradient Algorithm, for this particular approach. And finally, policy reward. Now, reinforcement learning representation and algorithm kind of requires a reward function that is really important here. So what we have done is, so we know that where we want to reach. We want to reach the final pose where the protein and the ligand are completely and optimally docked. And what we have now is protein and ligand separated in space. So an RMSE calculation of the ligand's current position with the final position where the ligand needs to reach kind of gives us an idea how good the agent is performing. So RMSE, we would want to minimize the RMSE. So root mean square error between ligand's current position and the final position, we would want to minimize. So our policy reward was designed in such a way that for a lower RMSE, the agent gets a higher reward, and for a higher RMSE, the agent gets a lower reward. And for technology stack, we use TensorFlow for the modeling of the machine learning aspects. And for chemistry and biochemistry, we use RDKit, OpenBabel, and DeepChem for molecular representation and extracting of molecular features. So the next thing is the challenges which we faced during this process. So the major challenge was model convergence. So RL training process is an optimization process. And in every optimization process, there is a high probability that the model would get stuck in a local optima, and that actually happened with us. So our model convergence was a real issue, which can be brought in because first and foremost, we have a huge action space which we need to generate. So there is, we have 6 variables to generate in the continuous space. So that's a huge action space. Secondly, the model would saturate pretty quickly. So that led to the model convergence issue. And the next challenge was coming up with the right reward function. As I mentioned earlier, rewards in an RL training process is one of the most important things which is required. So an example of a bad reward would be, I'll take the example of a snake game. So if I design a reward system where in the snake game, if the agent takes for every step that is non-score providing, the agent is penalized, what the agent is going to do is it will try to minimize the penalties. And the only way it can do that is by quickly going and hitting a wall. So reward here kind of plays a really important role in deciding whether the model would converge or not converge, or whether we would get the right results from it. Now I'll hand it back over to Shraddha to talk about Delhi. Thank you.
Thanks, Justin. So these were the two projects so far in the lead discovery space that we were talking about. The third project, this is the last one that we will be talking about, is the classification of compounds for Delhi. Delhi is drug-induced liver injury, and this falls in the preclinical stage, of the whole drug discovery design. So now we have, we spoke about generating the key, generating a drug, and then using reinforcement learning to understand its fitment better. So now in this, we are going to be seeing, once a drug has been created, what are the chances that it will be toxic to the body? And in this particular case, it would be toxic on the liver. So adverse drug reactions are a major threat to the development of novel drugs and their therapeutic use. And one such is the drug-induced liver injury that we are talking about, which causes liver damage. There are more than 700 drugs that have been found to be associated with liver injury. And DILI, drug-induced liver injury, has been the single most frequent cause of safety-related drug marketing withdrawals in the past 50 years or so. And it is continuing in the present as well. So the mechanisms underlying DILI are complicated and diverse, which makes its toxicological study difficult. And hence, we use the available data sets that we already have of drugs and its effect on the liver, whether it has been toxic or not. We use these data sets to create a model which can help in classification before it actually even goes to the clinical stages. So in this particular problem statement, again, we gathered data from various sources such as the NCRT, LIW, Green, and XUs. From these, so we basically over here get drugs and they have a label or a tag attached to them, whether they were toxic or not. So we gathered this data and we split them into training and test sets. The format for this is a little different. It is not simply the sequences that we saw in the GAN problem statement, but they are a different format called SMILES. So we need to take this format and create it into a form which can be given to a machine learning or neural network model. So we used deep learning in this. Now, in order to do that, we converted SMILES, the SMILES data, into different forms. We generated fingerprints such as the Morgan and the MACCS fingerprints, which are the most common molecular fingerprints. These are ways to represent these SMILES as mathematical objects. By doing this, we can perform statistical analysis and use the machine learning techniques on the set of molecules to classify into DILI or not. Along with generating fingerprints, we also generated descriptors about those molecules, such as the charge, harmonic topology, Mora and Gary, etc. These are, again, some properties. You can think of them as properties of the molecules which are there. So now we have this data into a more numerical representation, which signifies each of the SMILE data that we have. And we give this to the deep learning network that we created, which created a classification model. And then we went ahead and did some prediction on that. So we took our train and test data sets from the various benchmark data sets that are available online. We generated fingerprints and descriptors for that to give it to the deep learning model to classify a particular drug as either toxic or non-toxic for liver injury. The standard for this was 70%. We were able to achieve an accuracy of 76.94%. We tried various different types of modeling, various combinations of hyperparameters in the deep learning as well. We did get, in some cases, we did get a higher accuracy of about 85%, but accuracy is not the only measure for evaluation. There are certain other measures as well, such as specificity, sensitivity, and usually one needs a trade-off of all of them. So the model that gave an accuracy of 76.94% gave a good trade-off amongst all the evaluation criteria. The technology stack for this, we use TensorFlow for our deep learning model. We use RDKit BioMed, PyBioMed for generating our fingerprints and descriptors. Scikit-learn was also used for modeling of the different models that we wanted to try out, different machine learning models that we wanted to try out. So to tie all of these together, the two main areas in the drug discovery pipeline that we were focusing on were lead discovery and preclinical trials. In lead discovery, we started off with the GAN-based antiviral peptide generation and reinforcement learning-based post-identification. And then in the preclinical test, we worked on creating computational pipelines for identifying drug-induced liver injury. Now, for the GAN-based antiviral peptide generation, the benefits of this is that it provides an alternative method for peptide generation in wet lab. Hopefully, it would be faster. It would be a faster start to scientists in the peptide therapeutics. The novelty of this lies in, first of all, training on high quality and very limited data set. So A data set of 130 data points is basically nothing in today's world. It is very, very, very small. And being able to create a model that can still identify and generate peptides based on these 130 peptides is one of the novelty of this method. The other is the novel variety of the peptides itself. So I'll take the example of chess over here. So chess is a game that has been played for years. A lot of strategies have been developed. A lot of strategies have been studied in chess that can be played. Now, when recently machine learning and deep learning algorithms were introduced, again, they were trained in adversarial format, playing against itself to basically train itself on how to play chess. And even after playing this game and studying this game for so many years, the machine learning was able to identify strategies which are very different, which were not played earlier on in all these years. So similarly, we hope that in this particular GAN as well, we are able to generate novel varieties of peptides, which may not be the mainstream way of generating peptides, and hence include more novelty in the types of peptides. Now, in the reinforcement learning, the benefits of this project that we see is the limited manual intervention as compared to traditional methods and a learned optimization function that would mimic molecular docking. The major novelty of this project is the molecular representation for reinforcement learning. As Justin had already mentioned, that we used graph neural networks to represent it from 3D to 2D structures and then also add in other properties so that information is not lost. So this molecular representation was a major part of this project, and the active site identification. Going to drug-induced liver injury, definitely we want to be able to classify drugs earlier on before they reach the clinical stages, whether there is a risk of failure or not at a later stage in the drug discovery, because the later we identify a failure in the whole drug discovery process, the more expensive it is because already so much time has been spent on it. And hence, we hope overall it would contribute to a reduction in the overall timeline. So we did have, we tried out various multiple machine learning methods for this, and we tried out a lot many more fingerprints in this particular project than usually is tried out in these methods. Pooja, do you want to take over and add to this? You are on mute, Pooja.
Yeah, very well summarized, Shraddha. I'll just add on. So if you look at all of these pieces independently, so we see that, you know, the GAN-based one is generating the keys, reinforcement learning-based method is optimizing it, and preclinical test, the computational pipeline for DLE is classifying the compounds. So all of these are some independent pieces which in their own purview, they are automating a piece of the drug discovery cycle. They are, so if I have a known, say tomorrow, if another outbreak happens, you know, or for an existing disease, I know protein, I know the existing molecules, but I don't have something which is working out. Using a system like GAN-based method or using a generative method tool, which can quickly give me generated keys. And then I can take those keys forward and see, you know, which of them fits. Another method gives me that. Then I look at, okay, these are my final compounds. Can I quickly know, and it's not that quick as I'm saying, but yeah, can I quickly know that, you know, are these really toxic or non-toxic compounds? Are they marginal? What kind of initial, you know, study I can take out of it before taking it to the overall wet lab process? So those individual pieces can actually be taken into a bigger framework, can prove to be a platform for the entire drug discovery pipeline. Although we are just taking a small piece of it, like lead discovery right now, but having that, that's a part of our next step where we want to look at can we have some retrainable frameworks. So biology, protein data sets, gene, they are extremely unstructured, extremely unknown. It is very, very difficult to predict that, you know, can I have universal models that will always work? However, can we enable the scientists? Can we enable them to look at some of the retrainable frameworks which they can reuse based on the kind of data they have, based on the kind of information they have? Can they do that so that it, you know, it eventually it can evolve into a larger framework or as a platform which can eventually be used, utilized for the drug discovery process? Along with that, something that we also want to keep in mind and as a part of our next step is we want to ensure that all of our methods are compute efficient. A few of the challenges with the major existing processes or traditional methods is considering the chemical space. Now just imagine the example that Justin gave, a compound, a chemical compound which has say 10 bonds between two atoms. Now those, every bond has the capability of rotating. Now considering all those rotation, all those translations, and then identifying the right poles, right? It's quite a bigger space to cover. So ensuring that these newer methods, while they are data efficient, while they are giving us new method, they are also compute efficient so that we do not get into the older problems back. Additionally, for all of our problem statements, there is some more things that we are also exploring. Can we add more features? Can we add more structural features? Can we look at more of can we look at more of structural features, matrices which are already there, and see if we can train our algorithms better? So that was more or less all on the three problem statements and what are our next steps on those. A quick glimpse of what other things that we have been working on was the machine learning method for antimicrobial peptide classification. This paper covers the detail of the binary classification we did. We are now working on, once classifying as antimicrobial, to use them further. Can I classify them as being antibacterial, antiviral? That is something that is in progress. Then the another work that is more in a conceptualization phase is looking at the various databases that are already present, providing a linkage so that there could be a faster start to the research where I am looking for a particular protein or a particular genome and figure out that what all structures are available for that one. Another is the tsunami map of Indian diabetes, where we are studying, where we aim to study the known and unknown factors of prevalence and rise in prevalence of diabetes in India. So those are a very quick glimpse of a few other things that we are working on. Go next. Yeah, that is all we had for today. This is our fantastic team who has been working tirelessly over the last almost, I guess, 1 year on all of these problem statements. And I would like to acknowledge our collaborator and mentor, Dr. Jayaraman, Dr. Manali Joshi, and Dr. Vijayaram for a couple of discussions, and the Drug Discovery Hackathon Committee for giving us this opportunity. Thank you, and we are open for questions.
Thanks so much, Pooja, Shraddha, and Justin. That was fantastic. I've already been watching the E4R team is on the chat messages and have been answering all your questions. If you have any more questions, this would be a great time to share them. You can add them in the chat. And if there's something you'd like to share with the group verbally, you can also do that. So please feel free. And also I have a slide for the next session coming up on May 6th, simulation framework to model epidemics in large cities. Thanks. Okay, I'll stop sharing that. And then if there aren't any questions, I don't see any right now, but I don't have my chat available. If anyone wants, thanks, Steffi. Ah, okay, there's a question from Silanki. How do you use DL neural network to differentiate between a toxic and non-toxic drug?
Right, so I can take that up. I guess this is related to the third Delhi project that we were talking about. But also in general, if we think about it, differentiating between toxic and non-toxic drug is a classification problem statement. We use deep learning in a supervised form. So a supervised form is basically where we have the drugs and we have its labels as well, whether it is toxic or non-toxic. And we give this data to a supervised learning algorithm, such as deep learning in this case. And then it trains on the way, like a normal classification problem statement to differentiate whether it is toxic or non-toxic. The main crux lies in representing these drugs. So taking it from the SMILES format and actually representing it using its fingerprints and descriptors and then giving it to the model. I hope that clears it.
Thank you, Shara. All right, Felicia has also shared a message in the chat. You briefly touched upon biomarker identification. What methods or tools could be used for working with patients' data? So ML for multi-comics and multi-cohort meta-analysis.
So we haven't worked on that so far, but I'm thinking from a target identification perspective. A few things that can be utilized is on the pathway analysis, where you can do some kind of network analysis, which exactly ML method will fit in there, and or the knowledge graphs would fit in there, or what would fit in there. It's difficult to say that. But from an example like metabolomics data, where you have the flux values. So those can be very similar to what you have utilized in other methods. For places where you have more of network information, then some kind of network analysis would be a better approach to use that. And this is at a higher level. We currently are not working on any of those, but those could be explored based on what kind of data we have.
Thank you, Pooja. We're getting some thank yous in the chat. Great. Well, we're keeping an eye on the chat. So if you have questions, keep them coming. And if any of our speakers or anyone from the E4R team would like to offer some words to as finishing thoughts or closing thoughts, that's also very welcome.
Hey, thanks, Jenna. Thanks for those beautiful questions as well. It really shows the interest. I would like to just probably give an intro to our next session, which is around modeling virtual epidemics to tackle real ones. We'll be covering in-depth modeling and simulation as a domain and as well as two frameworks that we built. One is EpiRust, which is developed in the Rust language, and one is BharatSim, which is a simulation for multi-diseases, socioeconomic predictions, interventions for India at the moment. So we'll be covering these two frameworks in the next E4R session.
Wonderful. Thanks very much, Jaya. All right. Okay. Well, it looks like your questions have been shared. We hope you learned so much today. I want to thank everyone for joining, and I want to thank our speakers for a fantastic talk. And we're looking forward to seeing you again at the future sessions. And if you want more info, you can find that on Meetup. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you, everyone. If any of you need